The Latin term Characteristica Universalis, commonly interpreted as universal characteristic or universal character in English, is a universal and formal language imagined by Gottfried Leibniz and is able to express mathematical, scientific, and metaphysical concepts. Leibniz thus hoped to create a language usable within the framework of a universal logical calculation or calculus ratiocinator. The Characteristica Universalis is a recurring concept in the writings of Leibniz. When writing in French, he sometimes employed the phrase spécieuse générale to the same effect. The concept is sometimes paired with his notion of a calculus ratiocinator and with his plans for an encyclopedia as a compendium of all human knowledge. Many Leibniz scholars writing in English seem to agree that he intended his Characteristica Universalis or universal character to be a form of pasigraphy or ideographic language. This was to be based on a rationalized version of the principles of Chinese characters, as Europeans understood these characters in the 17th century. From this perspective, it is common to find the Characteristica Universalis associated with contemporary universal language projects like Esperanto, auxiliary languages like Interlingua, and formal logic projects like Frege's Begriffsschrift. The global expansion of European commerce in Leibniz's time provided mercantilist motivations for a universal language of trade so that traders could communicate with any natural language. Others, such as Janek, for example, have observed that Leibniz also had other intentions for the Characteristica Universalis, and these aspects appear to be a source of the aforementioned vagueness and inconsistency in modern interpretations. According to Janek in 1996, the Leibniz project is not a matter of logic, but rather one of knowledge representation, a field largely unexploited in today's logic-oriented epistemology and philosophy of science. It is precisely this one-sided orientation of these disciplines which is responsible for the distorted picture of Leibniz's work found in the literature. As Kutcherat wrote, Leibniz criticized the linguistic systems of George Delgarno and John Wilkins for this reason, since they focused on practical uses rather than scientific utility, that is, for being chiefly artificial languages intended for international communication and not philosophical languages that would express the logical relations of concepts. He favors and opposes to them the true real characteristic, which would express the composition of concepts by the combination of signs representing their simple elements, such that the correspondence between composite ideas and their symbols would be natural and no longer conventional. Leibniz said that his goal was an alphabet of human thought, a universal symbolic language for science, mathematics, and metaphysics. According to Kutcherat, in May 1676, he once again identified the universal language with the characteristic and dreamed of a language that would also be a calculus, a sort of algebra of thought. This characteristic was a universalization of the various real characteristics. Kutcherat wrote that Leibniz gave Egyptian and Chinese hieroglyphics and chemical signs as examples of real characteristics writing. This shows that the real characteristic was for him an ideography, that is, a system of signs that directly represent things and not words, in such a way that each nation could read them and translate them into its own language. In a footnote, Kutcherat added, elsewhere Leibniz even includes among the types of signs musical notes and astronomical signs, the signs of the zodiac and those of the planets, including the sun and the moon. It should be noted that Leibniz sometimes employs planetary signs in place of letters in his algebraic calculations. Hartley Rogers emphasized the metaphysical aspect of the Characteristica Universalis by relating it to the elementary theory of the ordering of the reals, defining it as a precisely definable system for making statements of science. Universal language projects like Esperanto and formal logic projects like Frege's Begriffsschrift are not commonly concerned with the epistemic synthesis of empirical science, mathematics, pictographs, and metaphysics in the way Leibniz described. Hence, scholars have had difficulty in showing how projects such as the Begriffsschrift and Esperanto embody the full vision Leibniz had for his Characteristica. The writings of Alexander Goad suggested that Leibniz's Characteristica had a metaphysical bias which prevented it from reflecting reality faithfully. Goad emphasized that Leibniz established certain goals or functions first, and then developed the Characteristica to fulfill those functions. In the domain of science, Leibniz aimed for his Characteristica to form diagrams or pictures, depicting any system at any scale and understood by all regardless of native language. Leibniz wrote, And although learned men have long since thought of some kind of language or universal characteristic by which all concepts and things can be put into beautiful order, and with whose help different nations might communicate their thoughts and each read in his own language what another has written in his, yet no one has attempted a language or characteristic which includes at once both the arts of discovery and judgment, that is, one whose signs and characters serve the same purpose that arithmetical signs serve for numbers and algebraic signs for quantities taken abstractly. Yet it does seem that since God has bestowed these two sciences on mankind, he has sought to notify us that a far greater secret lies hidden in our understanding, of which these are but the shadows. P.P. Wiener raised an example of a large-scale application of Leibniz's Characteristica to climatic science. A weather forecaster invented by Athanasius Kircher interested Leibniz in connection with his own attempts to invent a universal language. Leibniz talked about his dream of a universal scientific language at the very dawn of his career as follows. We have spoken of the art of complication of the sciences, i.e., of inventive logic. But when the tables of categories of our art of complication have been formed, something greater will emerge. For let the first terms, of the combination of which all others consist, be designated by signs, these signs will be a kind of alphabet. It will be convenient for the signs to be as natural as possible. Example, for one, a point, for numbers, points, for the relations of one entity with another, lines, for the variation of angles and of extremities in lines, kinds of relations. If these are correctly and ingeniously established, this universal writing will be as easy as it is common, and will be capable of being read without any dictionary. At the same time, a fundamental knowledge of all things will be obtained. The whole of such a writing will be made of geometrical figures, as it were, and of a kind of pictures just as the ancient Egyptians did, and the Chinese do today. Their pictures, however, are not reduced to a fixed alphabet, with the result that a tremendous strain on the memory is necessary, which is the contrary of what we propose. Nicholas Rescher, reviewing Cohen's 1954 article, wrote that Leibniz's program of a universal science, Scientia Universalis, for coordinating all human knowledge into a systematic whole comprises two parts, one, a universal notation, Characteristica Universalis, by use of which any item of information whatever can be recorded in a natural and systematic way, and two, a means of manipulating the knowledge thus recorded in a computational fashion, so as to reveal its logical interrelations and consequences, the calculus ratiocinator. Near the end of his life, Leibniz wrote that combining metaphysics with mathematics and science through a universal character would require creating what he called a kind of general algebra in which all truths of reason would be reduced to a kind of calculus. At the same time, this would be a kind of universal language or writing, though infinitely different from all such languages which have thus far been proposed, for the characters and the words themselves would direct the mind, and the errors excepting those of fact would only be calculation mistakes. It would be very difficult to form or invent this language or characteristic, but very easy to learn it without any dictionaries. The universal representation of knowledge would therefore combine lines and points with a kind of pictures, pictographs or logograms, to be manipulated by means of his calculus ratiocinator. He hoped his pictorial algebra would advance the scientific treatment of qualitative phenomena, thereby constituting that science in which are treated the forms or formulas of things in general, that is, quality in general. Since the Characteristica Universalis is diagrammatic and employs pictograms, the diagrams in Leibniz's work warrant close study. On at least two occasions, Leibniz illustrated his philosophical reasoning with diagrams. One diagram, the frontispiece to his work, De Arte Combinatoria, on the art of combinations, represents the Aristotelian theory of how all material things are formed from combinations of the elements earth, water, air, and fire. These four elements make up the four corners of a diamond. Opposing pairs of these are joined by a bar labeled contraries, earth, air, fire, water. At the four corners of the superimposed square are the four qualities defining the elements. Each adjacent pair of these is joined by a bar labeled possible combination. The diagonals joining them are labeled impossible combination. Starting from the top, fire is formed from the combination of dryness and heat, air from wetness and heat, water from coldness and wetness, earth from coldness and dryness. Leibniz rightly saw that creating the Characteristica would be difficult, fixing the time required for devising it as follows: I think that some selected men could finish the matter in 5 years, later remarking, and so I repeat, what I have often said, that a man who is neither a prophet nor a prince can ever undertake anything of greater good to mankind of more fitting for divine glory. But later in life, a more sober note emerged. In a March 1706 letter to the Electress Sophia of Hanover, the spouse of his patron, he wrote, "It is true that in the past I planned a new way of calculating suitable for matters which have nothing in common with mathematics, and if this kind of logic were put into practice, every reasoning, even probabilistic ones, would be like that of the mathematician. If need be, the lesser minds which had application and goodwill could, if not accompany the greatest minds, then at least follow them. For one could always say, let us calculate and judge correctly through this, as much as the data and reason can provide us with the means for it. But I do not know if I will ever be in a position to carry out such a project, which requires more than one hand, and it even seems that mankind is still not mature enough to lay claim to the advantages which this method could provide." In another 1714 letter to Nicholas Raymond, he wrote, "I have spoken to the Marquis de L'Hopital and others about my general algebra, but they have paid no more attention to it than if I had told them about a dream of mine. I should have to support it too by some obvious application, but to achieve this it would be necessary to work out at least a part of my characteristic, a task which is not easy, especially in my present condition, and without the advantage of discussions with men who could stimulate and help me in work of this nature. Eventually, by discovering binary digits again from Chinese works, which was now from the I Ching, Leibniz arrived at what he felt was a discovery of a link that would thereby create his Characteristica Universalis. It eventually created the foundations of symbolic logic and modern philosophy, specifically the predicate-based analytic philosophy and Boolean logic. C.J. Cohen set out three criteria which any project for a philosophical language would need to meet before it could be considered a version of the Characteristica Universalis. In setting out these criteria, Cohen made reference to the concept of logistic. This concept is not the same as that used in statistical analysis. In 1918, Clarence Irving Lewis, the first English-speaking logician to translate and discuss some of Leibniz's logical writings, elaborated on logistic as follows. "Logistic may be defined as the science which deals with types of order as such. It is not so much a subject as a method. Although most logistic is either founded upon or makes large use of the principles of symbolic logic, still a science of order in general does not necessarily presuppose or begin with symbolic logic." Following from this, Cohen stipulated that the universal character would have to serve as an international auxiliary language enabling persons speaking different languages to communicate with one another. Symbolism for the exact and systematic expression of all present knowledge, making possible a logistic treatment of science in general. This symbolism could also be expanded to accommodate future knowledge. An instrument of discovery and demonstration. These criteria, together with the notion of logistic, reveal that Cohen and Lewis both associated the Characteristica with the methods and objectives of general systems theory. Inconsistency, vagueness, and a lack of specifics in both English language translations and modern English language interpretations of Leibniz's writings render a clear exposition difficult. As with Leibniz's calculus ratiocinator, two different schools of philosophical thought have come to emphasize two different aspects that can be found in Leibniz's writing. The first point of view emphasizes logic and language, and is associated with analytic philosophy and rationalism. The second point of view is more in tune with Kutcherat's views as expressed above, which emphasize science and engineering. This point of view is associated with synthetic philosophy and empiricism. Either or both of these aspects Leibniz hoped would guide human reasoning like Ariadne's thread and thereby suggest solutions to many of humanity's urgent problems. Because Leibniz never described the Characteristica Universalis in operational detail, many philosophers have deemed it an absurd fantasy. In this vein, Parkinson wrote, "Leibniz's views about the systematic character of all knowledge are linked with his plans for a universal symbolism, a Characteristica Universalis. This was to be a calculus which would cover all thought and replace controversy by calculation. The ideal now seems absurdly optimistic. The logician Kurt Gödel, on the other hand, believed that the Characteristica Universalis was feasible and that its development would revolutionize mathematical practice. He noticed, however, that a detailed treatment of the Characteristica was conspicuously absent from Leibniz's publications. It appears that Gödel assembled all of Leibniz's texts mentioning the Characteristica and convinced himself that some sort of systematic and conspiratorial censoring had taken place, a belief that became obsessional. Gödel may have failed to appreciate the magnitude of the task facing the editors of Leibniz's manuscripts, given that Leibniz left about 15,000 letters and 40,000 pages of other manuscripts. Even now, most of this huge necklace remains unpublished. Others in the 17th century, such as George Delgarno, attempted similar philosophical and linguistic projects, some under the heading of metaphysis universalis. A notable example was John Wilkins, the author of An Essay Towards a Real Character and a Philosophical Language, who wrote a thesaurus as a first step towards a universal language. He intended to add to his thesaurus an alphabet of human thought, an organizational scheme, similar to a thesaurus or the Dewey Decimal System, and an algebra of thought, allowing rule-based manipulation. The philosophers and linguists who undertook such projects often belonged to pansophical, universal knowledge, and scientific knowledge groups in London and Oxford, collectively known as the Invisible College and now seen as forerunners of the Royal Society. A wide variety of constructed languages have emerged over the past 150 years which appear to support many of Leibniz's intuitions. If indeed they do support Leibniz's vision of unified science, then the remaining question is whether Ariadne's unifying thread can be discerned among these various projects, leading to their integration. Raymond Piper claimed that Reiser's unified symbolism for world understanding in science, an expansion of his A Philosophy for World Unification, was inspired by Leibniz's Characteristica Universalis, and believed necessary for world understanding and unbiased communications, so that war may eventually be eliminated, and that a worldwide organism of peaceful human beings may gradually be established. The study of Boolean algebras and group theory in the 19th century proved correct Leibniz's intuition that algebraic methods could be used to reason about qualitative and non-numerical phenomena. Specifically, the members of the universal set of a Boolean algebra or group need not be numbers. Moreover, a fair bit of philosophy in theoretical science can be formalized as axiomatic theories embodying first-order logic and set theory. Note also how model theory has been employed to formalize and reason about such emphatically non-numerical subjects as semantics and pragmatics of natural languages. But these approaches have yet to result in any pictographic notations. Fearnley Sander went one step further, defining Leibniz's Characteristica as a combination of the algebra of logic, which Fearnley Sander defined as the calculus ratiocinator, and the algebra of geometry, defined as the Characteristica geometrica. Fearnley Sander suggested that this combination had come to pass with the rise of universal algebra. Some people other than Fearnley Sander working in the area of universal algebra, the study of the mathematical and logical properties of algebraic structures generally, do not believe that universal algebra has anything to do with the Characteristica. Palko, G.Y. Bulksa considered structured analysis for analyzing and designing hierarchic systems by using an iconic language, and suggested that such was an application of the universal characteristics Leibniz's project to the language of structured analysis and the formalization of an iconic control system. Kluge argued that Frege's landmark Begriffsschrift was consciously inspired by the Characteristica Universalis. Even though Charles Sanders Peirce, a founder of semiotics, believed that all reasoning was diagrammatic, the relation, if any, of the Characteristica to his existential graphs and to semiotics has yet to be explored in the English literature. Characteristica and the calculus ratiocinator, if and only if the digital computer is interpreted as a physical embodiment of the calculus ratiocinator. The work of Mario Bunge on the border of physics and metaphysics seems grounded in metaphysical presuppositions similar to those of Leibniz's Characteristica. Jacob Linzbach's transcendent algebra, a pisigraphy designed to allow the calculation of truth through manipulation of given facts following basic principles much like those used in mathematics, was inspired by Leibniz's Characteristica.